Alright guys, we are back in my garage for another video, and today we are going to be talking about Boost. And I know this is one of those things we all love to talk about. Everybody's asking how much Boost you're running, how much Boost different components can handle. But in reality, that's not the only important thing when you're trying to understand your car's performance or safety. In my opinion, it's definitely not the most important thing when you look at the bigger picture. And so I just wanted to make this video to talk a little bit more about how Boost plays into other aspects of your car and what we really should be paying attention to if we want to understand, you know, how fast our car should be, how safe different components are, and when you need to upgrade. And I even want to take a look at a compressor map so I can show you guys how to read it so you can better understand the efficiency of your turbo. So we'll go ahead and talk about that in this video, and hopefully you guys find it useful. Now, as always, for everybody that's new to the channel, I create these videos to help keep you updated on the latest developments in our community, as well as discuss technical topics so that we have a better understanding of how our engines work. So if you're interested in more videos like that, be sure to subscribe because there will be a lot more coming out in the future. So like I said, you know, we're usually talking about boost pressure for one or two reasons. One, of course, is to understand the performance of a car. So you want to basically describe how fast your car is, or you want to figure out how fast somebody else's car is, then you'll refer to boost pressure. The other thing is safety of components. So a lot of people will just ask me how much boost can the transmission handle, or the intake manifold, or my drive shaft, you know, all these different components. And like I said, in reality, it's hard for me to answer that question. Generally, I just can't answer it at all. And I know you guys don't like hearing me say that. It seems like I'm just, you know, dragging you along. But there are so many different things that can play an effect on how boost pressure works with everything else. One big thing, of course, is the turbo that you're running. A smaller turbo will run less air at the same boost pressure than a bigger turbo. So if I'm running the stock turbo at 20 PSI, that is not comparable to running a bigger turbo at 20 PSI with everything else being equal. And that's simply because the bigger turbo can flow more air. And remember, your engine is basically just a big air pump. So for most cases, the more air you push in, burn up, and push out the exhaust, the more power your car can make. So that's why running a bigger turbo can make a lot more power with everything else being equal. But a bigger turbo at a lower boost pressure could potentially put more risk to other components like your drive shaft, your transmission, and things like that. So that's why I have to know what the turbo is in order for me to understand, you know, what other components could be at risk. Another big factor is the fuel that you're running. And the reason is because if you run higher octane fuel, you can increase your ignition timing advance, which allows you to burn up more air inside the combustion chamber. So even at the exact same boost pressure, you'll be burning up more air inside of your engine, which can also create more horsepower. So 20 PSI on pump gas isn't necessarily the same performance as 20 PSI on E85. There are a lot of opportunities where you can increase the airflow without increasing the boost pressure. And I know that seems kind of weird, you know, how can a turbo flow more air at the same boost pressure? And I'm going to go ahead and hop over to this compressor map and show you guys exactly what I mean. So this is an example of a compressor map, and this is actually for an EFR 8374 turbo. This is the turbo that's on my 440i. So if you guys see, you know, the car in the background of my video with the turbo sticking out of the engine bay, this is the turbo that I'm running. And you can see a couple specs on the turbo. So it has a 62 millimeter compressor inducer and an 84 millimeter outer diameter. So that's just kind of how they characterize their turbos. You can basically say it's a 62 millimeter turbo. That's how most people reference their turbos nowadays. Now, it's not a 6284, like if you're looking at precision numbers, the precision numbering system is different. So this is kind of like what a 6265 would be in the precision naming system. Anyway, so this is what a compressor map looks like. And there are two main things that you want to focus on. The bottom one is compressor flow in pounds per minute. And pounds per minute roughly translate to horsepower if you multiply them by 10. So at 50 pounds per minute, it's about 500 horsepower. At 65 pounds per minute, it's about 650. So this turbo from EFR or from BorgWarner is rated for 750 horsepower. So that kind of runs along this line. Now keep in mind, that's just a ballpark. You can't necessarily just tell how much power your car is making based on compressor flow, because there are other aspects of efficiency in an engine that can determine the actual power it's making. So this is just kind of the reference system that people have been using for decades. Now, the other thing, and probably what's more important to this discussion, is the pressure ratio. And this is basically a multiplier of pressure compared to ambient. So at all times, we have 1 bar of ambient pressure pushing on our body. That's around 14 PSI. So everything that you make above that is positive pressure. So in the case of your turbo, for example, if you're making 14 PSI, it's making 14 on top of the ambient 14 PSI you would experience otherwise. So that's what this pressure ratio is looking at. At 1 bar, you're basically making 0 PSI on your turbo because you only have the 1 bar of ambient pressure. At 2 bar, you're basically doubling ambient pressure. So now you've got the 14 ambient plus an additional 14 on top coming out of your turbo. So 3 is 2 bar, 4 is 3 bar, and so forth. That's kind of how you multiply things out. Now, as you can see, for example, if we look at the 3.0 pressure ratio, that is about 2 bar of boost pressure on your turbo. If you go across this line, you can see it goes anywhere from 35 pounds per minute, which is 350 horsepower, all the way up to 75 pounds per minute, which is 750 horsepower. So how does that actually work? And the reason is because there are a lot of things that can control the efficiency of your turbo and basically allow it to ride along this line. Now, you want it to be as close to this middle area as possible. This is where your turbo is the most efficient. It'll generate the least amount of heat for a set amount of boost and things like that. But really, anywhere in here is key, as long as you pay attention to, you know, any limiting characteristics. For example, a big one on EFR turbos is the shaft speed. So they've got these lines showing the shaft speed and how you can kind of limit your boost pressure based on a speed that you don't want to go over. But like I said, at 2 bar of boost pressure, how can we make, you know, 400 horsepower difference? Well, one big one, of course, like I said, is the fuel. Better octane allows you to burn more air in the engine. Another thing is ambient conditions. You know, a lot of people know cooler air is more dense, and so that allows you to flow more air at the same boost pressure. So your car at 20 PSI in winter will be a lot faster than 20 PSI in the summer. Same deal here. So this is all about actual airflow correlated to a set boost pressure. So you can see even turbo companies know that a set amount of boost pressure doesn't determine a set amount of airflow or horsepower. There is a wide range where the turbo can perform, and that's what they illustrate on this chart. You want to try to, you know, keep everything in a range where it's efficient typically, but a lot of people just push boost as high as possible on a turbo because it will make more power, and then you can just upgrade your cooling and other things to, you know, fix the efficiency losses. So that's kind of how I read a compressor map. You know, it's actually pretty simple when you just understand what the two different legs are. And it also helps illustrate, you know, how a set amount of boost pressure doesn't mean that your car is making a certain amount of horsepower or torque or things like that. There's really a wide range of horsepower that your car can make based on a set amount of pressure with all the other ambient things being equal. Another thing, of course, is reducing any restrictions. So getting a bigger intake, a higher flowing downpipe, a higher flowing exhaust, you know, all of those things can allow your car to make more power. Some people say, oh, you know, I removed my exhaust and now I've just got a dump tube coming off my downpipe and it makes more power. Again, that's freeing up airflow, allowing the turbo to make more power even at the same boost pressure. So all of those things can have an effect on how much power your car is actually making. So hopefully one thing you do see me keep falling back on is this airflow measurement. And this is what we base all of our horsepower ratings on for turbos. And it is, you know, the most critical factor when you're considering horsepower on your car. At least that's what I like to focus on. Unfortunately, a lot of our cars don't do a good job of measuring airflow. So on a Gen 1, the mass airflow sensor may or may not even be used. Like on my top mount kit, I don't have one. And on Gen 2 engines, they don't have a MAF sensor at all. So that's usually what you would use to try to measure airflow. But on our cars, it's not really used in that way. Instead, our cars try to use other sensors and put them together to calculate how much airflow is actually going through your engine. And I would say the easiest way to tell that is by looking at your load curve. So if you look at your logs, you'll be able to see load request, actual limit, you know, different things that your tuner has set. And if that load is going up, generally speaking, that means that your horsepower is going up. And a lot of times tuners will use that as they're going through the logs to see if they can increase load down low or up top to increase torque and horsepower and make your car hit a certain performance expectation. But if you're increasing load, that's effectively increasing airflow and pushing more air through the engine, which should make more horsepower. So personally, I feel like that's probably the most important thing to focus on. Where that horsepower is being made also determines how much torque your car is making and can also create other issues with limits on your car as far as, you know, like I said, drive shafts and stuff where you don't want to damage them. Working with your tuner will give you the best opportunity to keep yourself at a safe tune to avoid overwhelming any part of your system. But yeah, you know, I just thought that this would be a good opportunity to look at boost pressure again and explain why a lot of those questions aren't that simple. I can't just say this is the boost pressure where everything blows up, or this is the boost pressure and this is what time you'll make. You know, there are just a lot of different things that come into play when you're trying to correlate boost pressure with performance or reliability and things like that. So yeah, hopefully this answers the questions that you guys might have, or at least explains why the answer might not be that easy. And let me know if you guys have any other thoughts, or if you think, you know, this makes good sense. But yeah, I think that's it for this video. Thank you guys for watching, and I hope this helps. And if you have any other questions or comments, leave them down below.